Hey everybody, welcome to the Drum Hang. We are back. Had a little vacation time and putting kitchens together and all that kind of stuff in my house, so that's been fun. And I hope you had a good summer, and in some places it's still summer full on. It's still pretty warm here, so enjoying the days. And I hope everybody's safe and well and healthy and making music. All right. Today we are going to talk about tuning. You know, there's so many courses in the school, and you know, all of them are designed to help you find your way to make whatever you want to say on the drums yours. It's not about you know, trying to say this is the only way to do this. Of course, there's many ways, but I got really into experimenting when I was very young. It really kind of hit me when I first heard Steve Gadd play, because his sound was just so in your face, and I had never really heard anything like that. Most of the music I had heard and the drummers that I heard was either bigger, open, natural sounds, or kind of coming from a more of a rock, real muffled sound. So Steve was kind of one of the first ones to play smaller drums that were tuned lower, with thicker heads. So I really got into that and experimenting, and my drums kept getting smaller when I was younger. And for a long time I was playing an 8-inch tom, 10, and those were my two rack toms. With that approach though, I was always relying on microphones, because the smaller the drum, the thicker the head, the less projection, the less sound you actually have, which can be great for softer applications. But you know, the whole thing with tuning is always, with like almost anything else, you know, in drumming here, is that it always depends on the music. It depends on the vision of the sound you want. Sometimes it depends on giving the authenticity of the style that you're going to play a little bit of a nod. For instance, you know, you wouldn't go play a piano trio gig with a rock and roll set with big drums and dead tuned tom-toms, right? So, you know, so those kind of things are always in my mind when I go to tune. Now, what I'm going to do today, I'm not going to get into anywhere near the detail. I mean, we got 2 hours on this course in the school, and I really get into all of the different types of tunings that I might use in a situation. But I'll give you a couple ideas today. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to start off by playing a little bit. And I just did a record date this week, so the drums are still tuned pretty well. And this one back here, this floor tom on this side, this is a brand new 16 that I just pulled out of the box with the new legs and the new mounting on it that Yamaha was nice enough to send me. So I haven't touched it. I just pulled it out of the box. Right now I got a little cloth on it so I can play it, because it's ringing a lot. So I'm going to demonstrate a little bit on tuning a big floor tom. And we'll see what happens, because I don't know if you have the same experience I do. But, you know, most of the time with these things, it takes a lot of experimentation. Sometimes it depends on the room, and, you know, the head combinations and relationships are very important. And I will say with these drums, and a lot of the drums, you know, this gaffer tape, duct tape, gorilla tape, is really helps me sometimes, especially with microphones. Generally, without mics, I'm wanting the drums to project, so I don't muffle hardly at all, if at all, depending on the volume of the band. Okay, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to play a little solo thing first with just the room mics. Okay, I'm not going to put on no reverb, no EQ, nothing. I'm just going to put on just the room mics so you can kind of hear the drum set as it is sitting right now, even though it's kind of tuned and muffled for the most part for mics. You get an idea of what it sounds like. And you know, the tuning, you know, the production of the drums should never be the determining point of how you sound, how you play. You know, the production aspect is always the icing on the cake, and it's more about the vision of really the production of it. The playing still has to be there, right? Okay. So I'm gonna just mess around and play kind of a tom-tom oriented solo, give you an idea of how they sound first with just the room mics, and then I'll switch and I'll play kind of the same thing and turn off the room mics and just turn on the regular kit. Okay, so let me get in and turn off reverb, and I have the drums muted, right? So I'm tapping the mic here. You see that? There's no drums, nothing's happening with the mics. Okay, so so all we got right now is room mics. All right, here we go. Turn this off. Okay, so now I will turn those room mics off and just turn the drums on with no effect and no room mic. All right, so now you're just hearing the individual mics by themselves. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to turn on a little bit of the room mics and add those to the mix here. Okay. Okay, now I'm going to turn on my little effect that I have here just to give a little bit of more ambience and body to the sound. Oops. Okay, so that's the full kit with the room mics, with a little bit of reverb, with very short room ambience, one second, 25 millisecond pre-delay, and the high end rolled down on that reverb. So, you know, yes, of course, the production, the mixing, all of that stuff has something to do with, you know, what's going on in the final aspect of what's going on music-wise, production-wise, when I'm in that situation to mix. But again, when you're playing live, maybe mics, maybe not, you know, it's all got to start with the balance of what's happening with your playing, with your tuning, how the cymbals and the tom-toms and the drums all match. So I think the first thing that I talk about is trying to have a balance with your kit and the way you play. So let's start talking about snare drum versus tom-toms. Now, I use Remo heads and muffling devices that I've helped create some with them, with Herbie May at Remo. And, you know, I've gone through different iterations of double ply heads and, you know, first I was playing pinstripes back in the day. Then I went to clear emperors for a while, which is a double ply head, and those work great for a real contained sound, more low end, a kind of a scooped mid range naturally. So you get that low end, you get the high end slap, and especially the lower you tune. Now those heads, in my opinion, any kind of head like that, a double ply head, doesn't sound too good if you tune them tighter. So for me, that was part of the whole experiment with smaller drums, tuning lower, so the drums resonated and with thicker heads. When I kind of left all of the electronics behind in the mid-90s, the 8-inch tom just wasn't making it for a couple reasons for me. Number one, if I tried to actually tune it acoustically high enough to get the sound out of it, it was too high. And then it just wasn't enough sound production and projection for me. So I kind of dumped the 8 and went 10, 12. And clear ambassadors, coated ambassadors, depending on the gig. For most fusion things now that I really want the drums to resonate the most, I'll use a clear head, because the coating on a coated head kind of contains it a little bit. So I want these drums to be as open as possible with that attack principle, right? So I don't have to add the high end in a mixing situation. So these drums are pretty flat right now. They're not. There's maybe a touch of high EQ on the mixer, but not a lot. For the most part, the drums, you know, I'm adding low end to the kick because I use an ambassador down there too, a coated. But the point of this is that all of the drums have the same heads on them. They're all ambassadors. So therefore, you know, of course the muffling will change it a little bit, but the bass drum, I don't use a lot of muffling. So therefore, what I use actually in the bass drum is one of these guys that I helped design. Oops, go this way. Kind of see it there. It's a felt tube that has clamps that you Velcro, these little C clamps that you Velcro to the bass drum. And they come in three different sizes. This is the middle size, which works very nice for a 20-inch bass drum. And then there's a smaller size here, an 18. And then there's a bigger one for 22s and 24s. And, you know, most of the time, I'll pack that pretty well at the base of the drum here. But with Remo's head that they make for Yamaha, for the front side of the bass drum, I generally don't have to muffle too much. I also have a bass drum muffler that I helped design, an external muffler. And I have it somewhere, but I forgot to grab it. And that helps too for more of the natural sound when you're not muffling internally or miking internally. But the whole point of this is that the attack principle of all the heads match. Okay, so that if I'm doing a combination of things around the drum set, all of those attacks are the same. The volume is similar, so I don't have to work my body harder and unnaturally is more important to get the volume to match each other. As you get older, you're gonna see that the path of least resistance is really a wonderful thing, and single ply heads will help achieve that. Now, for me, I never dent heads, so if you're denting heads, that's a positioning issue. It means that you're hitting the drum at too much of an angle, and therefore you're hitting it more with the point of the stick instead of the bead. And it could be the stick you're using too if it has more of a small bead on it. But most drumsticks have, you know, a pretty good size bead on it. And if you're hitting it flush, which we talk about in the technique course of setting up things so that you're hitting the drums in a natural position, you'll never dent a drum head. So that's something to consider. And single ply heads, they're just going to project more. Now, they're going to be trickier to tune lower. And, you know, I still like to tune lower, and they're going to have a lot more harmonic ringing characteristics than a thicker head will. Even a thicker head will still have those harmonics. So what I mean by that is, for example, if I hit this bass drum, and my vocal mic's on right now, you can hear things ringing, you know, and it's certainly not the bass drum, right? That's going to be these toms generally, and it could be a floor tom too, but for that pitch, these are the kind of things that I kind of work for when I'm really getting picky with my mic sound. Now, with no mics, it doesn't matter. You're never going to hear that, but a microphone, and that microphone, the overhead, will definitely hear that drum ringing. So that's a harmonic in the head, and if you hold the bottom, not really tuned all that great here, as far as evenness goes. Whatever's happening with the drum, it's kind of working, but if I just start, you hear the pitch go down. And it's always going to ring, you know, but you want to try to get it so that it's the least offensive and it lasts, you know, it's out of the way. So that's, if tighter I get there, the worse it is. So kind of got to mess around with it a little bit, see where I'm at. So here's the other problem, okay? Now, I haven't even talked about tuning yet, but like I said, I'm not going to get into that much detail, but there's also relationships. Now that I messed around with the bass drum, what's happening here? Okay, when I hit that 12-inch tom, that drum is ringing too much. So it's convoluted with, there's not a separation of tone. So I got to do the same thing. I kind of got to find that happy medium, not only with the drum tuning itself, but with the relationships and how one is affecting the other. Now, again, this is mostly a problem with when you're miking close, all right? But let's mess around with this for a minute. Okay, so that took care of the problem, and I pretty much brought it back to where I had it because that's where it was working before. There is a little bit going on with the bass drum, but in the grand scheme of things, when you're playing, is it really bad enough to worry about? You know, so let's see. No, don't really hear it. So, but when you hit one drum and that other one is ringing, that's a problem. So you got to work on those relationships. So let's talk about the tuning aspect. Again, it's a tough subject to talk about because so much of it depends on the vision of the drum sound in the song that you're going to play. And for me, the first thing that I do when I hear a song is, what do I want the bass drum and the snare drum to be doing? How do I want to use a smaller bass drum with a full head? Do I want to put a full head on a bigger bass drum so that it's more organic and more old school, more natural, more raw, you know, so it actually sounds like, you know, a retro drum set. That's what they used to do, right? There was no holes or stuff, you know, back in the 50s and 60s and, you know, maybe the 70s, they started to take the bass drum head off in there, and then the holes became popular to deaden it up, so they got that separation and that funky sound. But boy, if you go back to the, you know, the big band records and jazz records, you know, the drums were natural and the bass drum had a tone just like the rest of the kit. And I prefer playing that. It doesn't work for everything though. When you're trying to play that real tight funk thing, you kind of got to have that bass drum not lasting too long. So let's start with the bass drum. You know, for the bass drum, you know, it's like I said, coated ambassador, and for the most part, it's pretty low. It's pretty loose. If I tap on the head, it's certainly not papery. You know, there's really no wrinkles in the head if I push on it. But for the most part, this head is low. And the front one is also pretty low. And I've got two mics out there. So if the drum rings, I will contain that front head, usually with my external muffler now. So those are important. The bass drum, like I said, this is a 22 by, I think this is a 22 by 18. And I've got the muffler in there on the back head. And I may have a small one in the front too. Didn't look. Now, I am adding some low end, you know, in the, let's see where I'm adding, probably 60 something. That's where I usually go with EQ. And yeah, 64 hertz, I'm adding about 3 dB down there. And that is a bell curve. I'm using a solid state Logic, an SSL channel strip here, so I don't exactly know what the curve is of the EQ. But suffice it to say, I'm adding a little bit of low end. I'm taking out a little bit around 300, and I'm adding just a little bit of top end, also taking out a little bit at 1K. These heads are very, very mid-range happy. So you got to dump the mid-range if you want that kind of fat, funky sound. And, you know, it's a lot of the heads today, they have the, you know, the like the Power Stroke and similar. You know, they sound good out of the box. I'm not going to take it away from them. But again, it has that quality for me that makes my body work too hard in comparison to a snare drum when I'm playing just a regular ambassador like this. Okay, so I can't quite make my body comfortable to play these combinations of hand and foot things and make them even without a lot of extra work. Again, if I'm playing even in a groove thing. That transient attack, my body's got to feel natural. Like the effort I'm putting in is, you know, I'm getting return on investment for that. I'm getting the sound out, and it's really hard to get that out of a bass drum that's heavily muffled with a thick head on it. Okay, so low tune on the bass drum. Snare drum. Now, this one, again, you know, I go into a lot of detail on the site here on the lesson in school. But generally speaking, my bottom head is pretty cranked. And I generally control the tone of the drum with the top head. If I want it, to be fatter, I'll just loosen it up a little bit. And it really does, you know, characteristically work that way for me. Now, snare drum tuning kind of has everything to do with, again, the song and the harmonic content of the song, the harmonic aspect of the pitches going on. You know, of course you can't tune, you know, for every pitch, but in every key, every chord change, you know, of course it's all over the place. But there can be kind of a constant pitch that you go for. Now, right now I've got my little muffler on here from Remo that I helped design. You can kind of see it from the top. It's kind of a active muffler system that goes up. The plunger goes up and then it comes down to muffle the drum after the hit, so you can kind of see it work here. Without it, you can hear the drum ring a lot more. So that system works kind of cool. It lets the drum ring and then it kind of shuts it down almost like a noise gate. So it's a, you know, it's a physical noise gate, as it were. Can't control the release, of course, but it does a pretty cool job. And you can move it around to have it, you know, less or more. But anyway, that has a, I usually use that for the system. If I really want to muffle the drum, then I'll put some tape on either side of the rim shots where I hit them, or the strokes, right? So that it's even. Which of course takes some of the ring out of the drum and makes it harder to play. The more you muffle any drum, the harder it is to play. So I like to, like I said, that path of least resistance is very important for me, and I control the muffling with my playing. If I want the snare drum to be more of a muffled stroke, I'll actually deaden it with the stick in this manner. Generally, I never need to do that. Quite honestly, now that I'm not thinking about it, I sort of naturally do that anyway. I hit it and then I kind of rest the stick on the drum to let it muffle. So that's one thing. Anyway, so if I detune this drum a little bit, you know, I'll just go around evenly. And, you know, one thing, I'm gonna show this on the tom-tom that I pulled out with a new head on it, just to show you how, kind of a little bit about what I do from scratch. But just detuning the bottom head, or top head, that's a funkier sound, but it may not work for the pitch of a song. Now, I pulled up this song that I played a couple sessions ago when I had Jay Oliver on the session, and this is one of his tunes called Spurfunky, Spurfictory. I don't know what it is. I have to look at it. I'm going to play a little bit of this song and see how this tuning works, and I'm going to demonstrate a little bit about tuning for the song here. So let's see what happens. It kind of works, but for me, the pitch of it is conflicting a little bit. So, I can't sing for anything. But let's get a pitch here that Let me start this up a little farther. Right, bang, bang, bang. You know, like I said, I mean, almost anything can work, but I sort of get into this. You know, I like to have the snare drum be somewhere relative and you know, having something to do with the pitch that's going on. Boom, boom, boom. Let's So that's starting to, you know, for me, work a little better with the song. Now, this is when a drum is ringing, of course. When it's dead, it doesn't kind of really matter, right? So now I'm kind of in the ballpark with what's happening. Relationships, tuning of heads. I mean, again, the bottom head's always going to be tighter on all my drums. The relationship of how far or the interval changes. On snare drums, I don't really pay attention so much to the interval. I just get this head really kind of tight. Now this drum, all my signature drums from the past, this is a 30th anniversary brass drum. This drum and all those drums have 8 lugs instead of 10. So the tuning, I have to crank a little bit, but I just prefer the way an 8 lug drum sounds over a 10 lug drum. It's for some reason a little more open. So now what I just did, don't do that, okay? With the key, especially on wood shells, I used to do this all the time. And then when I changed heads one time when I was a kid, I looked at my bearing edge. There was all these slices in them. I'm like, how did that happen? And it was because I was going with the key right at the edge. Don't use the key. Use your finger. Okay. So, and it's still habit for me. I just generally tune, bam, bam, bam. So try not to do that. So this is tuned pretty well, pretty evenly, right? So for a snare drum sound, this button doesn't work so well. And what you want to pay attention to, for me anyway, when I'm tuning a snare drum, I want to make sure the rim shots sound the same. That could be your sticks. So make sure you test your sticks to try to make sure they're pitched correctly to begin with, because you have no idea how much that can affect the tonality of your strokes being even or not being even. It's like, man, I can't get an even single stroke or a double stroke roll. Check your sticks. Okay, make sure they're pitched the same, or at least close. Which Vic Firth is very good about, balanced and very, very even. Okay, that's a snare drum, tom-toms. Now, what I've done and what I do in the school in detail is, and I got my Birch Absolute kit, my 10-inch tom, and I just put a new head on it. This is untuned at the moment, so wrinkles and a whole bit. And generally, I always suggest, and sometimes I'm lazy too, I don't take the drum off, but it's always better if you got time and you could just sit and relax and take the drum off and tune it, you know, get it on your legs so that you're muffling the other side, or if it's a big floor tom, stand it, put it on your seat and stand up, you know, so you're actually muffling that head on, you know, with something. Because what you want to do is tune one head at a time. There I go again. Now, the bottom head I detuned a little bit because it's, again, you know, the idea is to get the lugs even. That's pretty much, and I go through a whole thing in the school about seating the head and all that kind of stuff, especially with Remo, that's important. So You hear that crack? That means that I'm seating the bearing edge. I'm seating the head in the hoop around this bearing edge. So it's important to do that. Now, I don't know if you can see the wrinkles here, but there's a lot of wrinkles in this head. So, you know, what I start doing after I finger tighten everything is I start doing this cross head, kind of like, you know, the lug nuts on a wheel. You never want to do just a round like that. You want to go from side across. Okay, so, and I always press center with the palm of my hand. Don't do it with your knuckles, especially on a single ply head. You'll dent the head. Okay, really not ready to tune yet. What I kind of do is I go through and I make sure that these wrinkles, you know, if you can see that, I don't know, if I make sure that those are gone, okay, when I'm pressing. And once they are, then I start tuning. This is tensioning. And I think there used to be a joke about Buddy Rich, what he said when somebody asked him, how do you tune your drums? He said, I don't tune, I tension. Okay, this is tensioning. And to some point, it's always tensioning, but tuning is another deal when you're wanting to get a pitch, where are you gonna go? And I got kind of nuts with it when, you know, I started paying attention to notes that guys would tune to. And, you know, with the jazz guys, I would listen to everybody and see where their pitches were for the top tom. And then I realized that for kind of the acoustic jazz situation, they would always, most times anyway, would tune a fifth between the floor tom and the rack tom, if there were two toms. And I like that. That's what generally what I tune to, is a fifth. So when you're talking about intervals, you got to study that. And there are, that's the one thing that I took away from my very short college career that helped me a lot was pitch training, voice, you know, interval training, and referencing songs. So for a fifth, dun, dun, that's the fourth, dun, 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 right? The 2000 thing, that song that, ba-da, right? So that's a fifth, and generally I would do that. Now for the rack toms, I generally always do a fourth here. So it's Here Comes the Bride, right? And that's a little low right now, so I have to relook at that. Anyway, so now comes the tuning, and that means that I'm gonna go through and get the head, get all the lugs even. That's the idea. After I do that, then it becomes a relationship of where is the pitch of this head according to the pitch of this head or compared to. So right now it's still higher. Let's see if. Yeah, not seated. Okay, so there's a perfect example of, you know, I'm tuning and I've done this a couple times and this head is brand new, so it's not seated, right? So you got to keep doing it as you tension the head. And some folks will like, and I would do this too, especially with a new set of heads. I would always tell people if I was going to do a clinic or something, I would say, tension the drums, seat the heads by doing this, you know, and over tension. In other words, really, really get it up there so that the head has a chance to seat. Because if you don't do this, what will happen is it will do it for you as you're playing. And you don't want that to happen, right? How many times you've been on a gig, you're playing it, and all of a sudden you hear that sound, you know? It's because the head is not seated, right? So we want to get that head seated. Right, so it's way up there right now, and in comparison, way higher than the bottom head. Now this bottom head is pretty old. And again, now we start kind of getting into where do I want the pitch of this drum to be? And I always remember when I was really studying Mr. Gadd when I was 17, 18, 19, I was like, where's that first tom? Where's that pitch, you know? And it was an F sharp. More than not, at least the things that I was listening to. So for the longest time, I would start with an F sharp and tune down from there. I don't do that anymore because sometimes F sharp doesn't work in the pitch of the song. And that's, again, sometimes I will tune within the song context if I got melodic sounding toms, which generally these are. So A lot of times seating like this is good. Yep, doing that key again. And I'm just going, you know, listening for the pitch, trying to get them even, okay? So now I'm off with, you know, the top head is higher than the bottom. And I don't like that sound. So right now, the last thing you're hearing is the bottom head ringing, which I don't like at all. And it kind of goes, it's all warble and stuff. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to start by matching. I'm going to bring up the bottom head to work with this pitch. Okay. So I'm going to bring it up. Okay, and all right, so now seat, did you hear how much that dropped? Even though this is an old head, tuning it is not good enough. You've got to seat it because it will always drop in pitch, always. So that's pretty in tune. Now, this happens to be, just by chance, the interval that I usually tune to, which is a minor third. Okay, lullaby, da da da, boo da, way, da 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 da. I can't sing, I really can't sing. Anyway, but I know the intervals if I hear them. So now the drum rings true, and that's how I want it. Now, in a school, I get into all kinds of manipulation, which is, what if it's ringing too much, with too long? I have ways of dealing with that. And come on into the school, sign up, and check out the details, okay? So anyway, that's kind of what I do for all the drums. And like I said, now I don't have currently a fourth that I like here. Can't hold on to anything today. So that's actually closer to a minor third as well. Right? And I want it to be a fourth. Bum, come the bride. Bum, bum. So it's low, right? So let's see where interval. Yeah, it's quite a bit lower. Again, I'm testing the lugs, right? So let's see where I am. So there's that fifth interval. Okay, so generally fourth, fifth here. And then once I get down to the low guys, it's kind of like, let's get as low as possible. That's kind of what I do with especially the lowest pitched drum on the set. I just get it really low, and the use of duct tape and other things help me. Okay, so that's kind of the ball game so far. Steve, do we have any questions folks may want to ask about some of this stuff?
Hey there.
And how are you, by the way?
I'm good. Learning a lot.
Yeah, sorry. I completely, I just kind of went right into it. Forgive me.
No one wants to look at my face. They want to watch you tune, so that's good. It's all good.
Yeah, all good. Yes. All right, well, welcome, Steve. Thank you for being here as usual. And
I actually, you know, watching you do this reminds me of when I was in college and I was like, I had a gig on a Saturday, and during the day I would sit and watch your Back to Basics video basically and tune with you. And I keep rewinding it and listening to what you said and go through this process. So it kind of reminds me of that. But and I know others watching today probably did that. But what's important to know is that you've really updated that sort of method a lot in the Dave Weckl Online School. So there's about 2.5 hours worth of Dave tuning drums in every possible way in the school. So if you're really interested in this, today's a great preview, but just go to daveweckl.teachable.com and you can get in there and subscribe. There's tons of other stuff in there, but the tuning course I think is the coolest one. So anyway, just wanted to make sure people know that. And we need more cameras. We really like get right up on you during that. So it's
absolutely lots of detail. Yeah, it's been a kind of a passion, you know, the experimenting. I just got really, really into it. And then adding the production aspect, the mixing aspect, which we also talk about really in depth in the school too. There's mixing and recording courses as well. So
Want to check it out. One question I see here, it just kind of deviates a little bit from it, but somebody is asking I'll put it up there. Oops, wrong one. These go a little
but
too quickly.
The answer to that is yes, ambassadors top and bottom.
That's right. There it is. Nylon sticks.
That says nylon washers.
Washer. Oh, you're right. It does say washers. Is that the same thing or no?
I'm not sure what a nylon washer is.
I know nylon sticks. Like.
Well, ticks. Nylon washers, I'm guessing maybe for the symbols, things. I don't know what you actually, you know, these are felt. I guess they're washers. I don't know. I've never heard that term, but.
Well, if someone wants to chime in, they can re-ask the question.
No. Generally, I don't like anything that's not felt. Felt allows the symbol to breathe more, in my opinion. Most everything else I've tried is too stiff, in my opinion.
Yeah.
But that's just me.
One thing in the school that I found interesting, when you were talking about like sympathetic overtones in other drums, and you just demonstrated that a little bit, but how much time do you spend going through the kit when you're like at a gig and things are resonating on the drum set? You have it tuned the way you want, but you just hear everything ringing, particularly when you hit one.
Yeah, I show up at the gigs, you know, for sound checks an hour before everybody else, and I spend a lot of time with the tuning and the miking and just making sure that the presentation of the kit is as close to as good as I can get it, how I want it, so that it's not a distraction later. So yeah, quite a lot of time is spent dealing with that. And sometimes, like I said, it's not just about the drum set itself. You know, there are, you know, external circumstances and lots of, you know, criteria that really play into what goes on with the drums on a stage. Is it hollow? What's going on with the room reflections? And, you know, are you sitting in a bass trap? What's the, you know, what? There's a lot of things that that really go into, you know, the whole process. So it's not easy to answer in a general way about details concerning, oh, what do you do on a live gig? And it depends on the gig always. Yeah.
Yeah, John Gill mentions this here. Sympathetic tuning between the small tom and the snare drum.
Yeah, I think a lot of people get really a little bit too crazy with that, in a sense of most of the time, you know, have to worry about it. I mean, if I turn on my snares and I hit my first tom, do I hear the snares buzzing? Yeah. Can you hear them now buzzing? Not enough for me to worry about it. But I understand what you're saying when it's really bad. Like when it grabs the snare and it just goes, that's a problem. And that happens, at least my opinion in my experience, is that happens when the tom-tom is too close in depth and pitch to the snare. So you got to get them far enough apart, and it's one reason why I never like 6.5-inch snare drums or deeper, is because that is harder to avoid, especially if you're tuning low everywhere. That's when I notice that it happens the most. So I stick with 5.5-inch deep maximum snare drums, and And you know, the 10, the way that I tune this whole system here, I don't have to worry about that too much. But it does happen. If I start tuning the snare drum really low and I get too close to this, yeah, then I'll get that real thing. So that's what that's about. You gotta sacrifice something in the tuning somewhere, you know.
Cool.
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah. Hey, I see a question here asking if the Ronald is asking if the snare drums are currently produced. No, they are not currently produced. Yamaha had to stop making signature drums. They about 5 years ago, well, more than that now, 2013 was my 30th year anniversary with Yamaha, and they made some anniversary drums for me. They made 150 of the brass shell 5.5 by 14, and they made 100 of the 5 by 13 maple shell. And those were limited edition drums. So yeah, they don't make them. The only place you'll find these drums and the previous generations are used. Yeah, there's still some people out there that took good care of, fortunately. So, but yeah, you'll pay for them at this point, because they're rare to find in good shape.
Yeah.
Cool. What else you got?
Well, I mean, there are so many amazing questions here. Some of them related a little bit to recording, but you actually get into that in the course, because you, I remember in the last part of the course, you actually do some A/B testing with how you record, you know, for different situations, recording situations where you're changing your tuning. And then of course that kind of bleeds over into the recording course. But for this recording you were doing this week, what are some of the approaches you were taking to it? Like what was the tune that you were doing?
Well, the tune I'm doing, I'm doing a few tunes for my friend Raimondos in, I'm not actually sure where he's from, but he's over there somewhere in Europe, and I've known him for quite a while, and he's finally getting his own record together. And this particular tune was very challenging, very difficult. It was like a, based in a 6/8 kind of groove in 7. So that was challenging to find a pocket to groove for that. But generally speaking, the drum set, like I said, this is kind of my fusion setup. This is what I use to record. Only the tuning changes. The ride cymbal may change. I wanted a little bit more open ride, so I use the 21-inch Legacy on this particular tune. But, and, you know, 18-inch crash here instead of a 17. But for the most part, I'm kind of consistent, unless I hear something that I need to be different, which in this case, there wasn't a need. So yeah, I'm getting quite a lot of, you know, songs to record for people, thankfully, which is great. And it's always very challenging to kind of try to find what people are after with their music. But the tuning has a lot to do with the presentation. Yeah, for sure.
I was just looking here at the course itself. I wonder if I can share the screen for a minute, because it'll just give people an idea of what you teach, actually, what's actually there. So let me try. I apologize if this doesn't work. Let's try.
I'm just looking through questions here, too. There's so many.
Yeah. But people might just want to see everything, because it's huge what you've got here.
I see somebody asking a question about, Ingemar is asking a question about the drum dial. I never tried it, actually. I don't know if it works. I'm sure it probably does, but anything else. Yeah, I like to use my ears and get my hands on the drums and just use, you know, back when I was experimenting with this, there was none of that stuff, you know, to help you. So I really don't know the product, to be honest. But you know, it's nice to get your hands on the drums and spend time tuning it just to see what happens. Don't be afraid to turn lugs. Don't be afraid to experiment, because that's the beauty. And also too, you know, don't get stuck sitting on top of your kit and thinking that's how it sounds. You know, when you tune it, get somebody to hit it. Go stand out in front of it and see what it sounds like. And then, you know, of course, too, when you're trying to tune for the studio situation and the microphones, that's a relationship too. So it, you know, that's why sometimes I will muffle a little bit more, you know, for the microphones, because it's like putting your ear right on the drum. They don't want to hear a bunch of harmonics and a bunch of ringing going on. So it all comes down to, you know, to what you're trying to do. What you doing there, Steve?
Well, this is the course. So just wanted to give people a quick overview of it and you get back to it. But you have an introduction.
I'm going to let you do that for 1 minute. I got to get a water. I neglected to get a water. I'm really thirsty. Stay hydrated, everybody. I'll be back in 20 seconds.
Uh-oh. Okay. Nobody wants to listen to me. But anyway, here's what we got. Seating and tuning the batter head, which we've gone through a little bit. Dave spends a lot of time on muffling the bass drum there. So we get him on the floor, he opens up the bass drum, and he sets those Remo pads into there and shows you how to do that. He handles ported and unported situations, talked a lot about that. So you can see that there. Gets into the toms, spends about 24 minutes on just the small tom. It goes through a second tom and his floor tom, and about 17 minutes is spent just on the snare drum. And then he evens out the kit and works on, at the end, the tuning effect that it has on the microphone. So he just ABs it for you a little bit so that you can really get an idea of how he arrives at his final sound. So it's pretty cool. And I was lucky enough to be standing there while you filmed all of this and learned a lot. Pretty cool.
Yeah. We definitely on all the courses get into a lot of detail, and they were fun to make. I'm working on some other ones now, some other courses and things. So stay tuned. I see some of our friends in the school that are here. Yeah. So, be more stuff coming, guys, for sure.
Absolutely. Here's one. Does weather play an important role in the tuning of the drum? What about when you're playing outside, when you're out with Chick and you're playing a lot of those outside amphitheater shows, whatever? Does that affect you?
Not really. I mean, it can. You know, it's not like playing a calfskin head or anything. I mean, I don't know about other companies, but with the Remos, I haven't really been affected. It brings back a funny memory, though. One time in the 80s, I was touring with Michelle Camillo and Anthony Jackson. We were somewhere in Spain. It was like an open air concert and no roof, you know. And we're playing, and it was being televised or something. And maybe the film is out there somewhere. I haven't seen it, but it started raining. And all I remember is Anthony unplugging and running to the cover because he didn't want to get electrocuted. And I was still playing, and it was like a rock video, man. It was like hitting the drums, and the water was splashing. Okay, side note. But drums still sounded good, even in the water. So, I haven't really had a problem with weather. Where my drums usually stay are pretty consistent. I will recommend in humid climates to get a dehumidifier so your stuff doesn't rust, you know, the rims and stuff like that. And it's generally kind of a good idea to, if you can, be in a relatively stable, temperature controlled environment for your stuff. But I see a question there. How does the touch mix help on the sound of your drum kit? Yeah, I use I use the touch mix, the QSC touch mix 16 at the moment. And it's a great little mixer, and I love it. And, you know, we've recorded my current record that we just released, which is a live show of my band that you can go and download anywhere, you know, that you like on streaming and download sites. It's the Dave Weckl Band live in St. Louis at the Chesterfield Jazz Festival, put on by Autumn Hill Records, which is where I'm coming to you from, Autumn Hill Studios here. And the record's on that label, and that whole record was recorded with two touch mixes, a 16 and 8 that I put together later. And fabulous mic pre's in a really small compact unit. So, but the mixer serves like any other mixer. I mean, it really is there to capture and enhance the sound of the acoustic set to begin with. You cannot take a poorly tuned drum and make it sound good. It's always going to sound like a poorly tuned drum, you know, amplified or, you know, mic'd. So just remember that it always starts with the basic idea of a tuning. And I saw somebody said, you know, oh, the drums sound great with the mics, but not so much with the natural room mics. Okay, you got to understand that, you know, first of all, the natural room mics are there and there, so they're not really in front of the kit. And we've got a lot of reflection in this room. The ceiling is wood. There's wood kind of everywhere except where the mics are. There's a little bit of carpet behind them. But you can see the one in the back corner there. So, and like I said, no EQ. So generally speaking, you gotta, if you're trying to get a natural sound, you know, that's when the room becomes very important, because these drums, you know, are tuned very well, and they sound great to me playing them as they are. But we're talking about the presentation and close miking. That's a whole art, like I said, of tuning and you know, and producing the sound. Although I don't do that much with the EQ, there's no compression going on or anything like that in what you're hearing. So, but generally speaking, for a sound like that, I would be using smaller drums tuned higher, you know, and that produces a whole other sound. 18-inch bass drum or a 20 with a full head. I prefer that sound if I'm going to play acoustically. Not a dead bass drum with a hole in it. So, yeah, of course, the natural, you know, mic to room mic sound is never going to sound as killer as a fully produced mic sound. But again, it starts with the production. Yeah, it starts with the tuning, right? So, I'd love to see Dave playing in the rain. It was fun. It was fun.
What about backline situations? You know, you show up, you're in Europe, there's a Yamaha kit there for you. I mean, do you pretty much loosen everything up and start from the beginning? Do you take the heads off? How do you go through that process?
I'm sorry, what was the first part of that? I was looking at a question here that distracted me.
Backline situations. Backline. When you are just, you know.
Yeah. Well, it depends. I mean, generally speaking, I don't go crazy to say, okay, take all the heads off and start from scratch. It's basic. I go the other way. I generally, like I said, in a backline situation, it's like new heads, seat them, tighten them, you know, and that, like I said, gives me a starting point from the opposite direction to where the heads are seated. I don't have to worry about that aspect, and then I kind of tune from there. And actually, sometimes if it's a borrowed kit, from a person, you know, and maybe I know the person, I say, tune it how you like it, and then I start from there if the heads are slightly used. So, I see a question here. Ever use a snare wire rail system, Dynasonic? I actually have a Dynasonic somewhere. And you just reminded me, Wayne, to actually look to see where that drum is, because I don't remember where it ended up. But yeah, I have an old Rogers. It's an old Rogers snare drum, Dynasonic. It's from, my particular version is from the mid 70s, I think, early 70s. It's kind of funny. I mean, it's all those drums, especially that one, it was never quite, it was really hard to dial that drum in to get it to sound good. But yeah, love Rogers drums, that's for sure.
How many snares do you have? I remember on your rack in California, you had 8 or 9 of them.
I'm not a crazy collector. I have a couple. You know, most of them were. You know, I've got a few extra examples of my signature drum, still in boxes actually, but not that many. A couple extra, and I have an old Slingerland from the 50s, a Radio King, and I've got a Leedy Slingerland from the 50s. And a couple of Ludwig 400s, you know. But other than that, I just, you know, I have no reason to play anything else. I love these drums. And the dual strainer setup here is a lot of the reason why. So, Hey, I see Lewis from the school. He said, "What's up with the two 16-inch floor toms?" Well, what I was going to do, Lewis, I was going to get into tuning the other 16, but we're kind of running out of time here. But like I said, the older Phoenix floor tom legs are not simply not as good as the newer ones, and they tend to loosen up a little bit. And the new model is they've changed the mounting of the legs. And I said, "Hey, man," I asked Yamaha in Japan. I said, "Just send me the legs. You know, just, I want to put them on the floor toms." And it's more complicated than that because it's different mounting systems. So they were nice enough just to send me another 14 and another 16. So I thought it would be a kind of a, you know, cool thing to actually tune this drum, because out of the box, okay, this is what it sounds like. All right. And let's see. So you can see it's still ringing, right? So I know that a lot of you probably suffer from the same thing that I do, which is floor toms that actually ring too long. And you know, there's a couple of, you know, so the first thing we all do is get the tape out and put tape everywhere. That helps, but again, that starts to degrade the sound. So on this side, as you can kind of see here, I did this in a hurry. I had a cymbal felt sticking around, hanging around, so I taped the cymbal felt. And I just roll up these guys and I put it on the bottom and the top. But generally, what I do is I'll take tissue paper, you know, like this, and you know, I'll tear them so that I've got these little guys, you know, like this sort of, and then a piece of duct tape, and I will take that and put it when I'm doing top and bottom of a low floor tom, if I really want it to be low pitched, you know, I'll take the gaffer tape, and you know, I'll do something like this to where, you know, I tape it, and I just put it, you know, I'll put one here, for example, and I will put one, got my pre-torn things here, so there, and I'll put one on the bottom. And that kind of helps contain things. So with that, you know, it's still ringing into next week. So, you know, that's too long of a ring. So at this point, tape and muffling is not going to really help. You got to start tuning. So at the moment, so the prescription for, you know, bottom head being a little bit tighter than the top is there. But again, this just doesn't work for, especially for a mic drum. So the first thing I would do, again, I haven't seated these drums, I haven't done anything to them. So again, generally speaking, I should take this and put it on the seat. But what I'm gonna do is start loosening this. And you know, so now we got some wrinkles here. So with a thin head, you can hear that it's growling, right? It's just, it's too thin on top. So it's, you know, too thin and it's too loose on top. So what I'm doing now with my finger, I'm pushing into center and I'm tapping around to see where it's loose, where it's too loose. So that side is a little bit too loose. That should be better a little bit. So this is where experimentation comes in. Now, if this drum is too low, you know, what I'll start doing is bringing up the bottom head. I'll start tightening the bottom so that the sound and the ring stops sooner. And it also brings up the pitch. Now, this is what I was talking about earlier, that's easier to do with a thick head, okay? Emperors, pinstripes, that type of thing. All right, so that's just the bottom head tuned up a little. Yeah, so as you can hear, it's higher pitched, it's more contained. Now, if I start getting into, you know, because I still want this drum on this side of the kit, I want this one to be the lowest on the kit, right? So I don't want this one, you know, in that ballpark, but I do want it to have the same characteristic. Now, there is a different mic on this drum, so it doesn't quite have the same texture. So I can kind of keep going here. And again, this is all experimentation that you sort of. Okay, so. So that quick little tuning demonstration kind of handled the ring on that. So bring up the bottom head, that'll keep the drum full and fat, and you detune the top head a little bit so that it stops quicker. So yeah, so Fernando Mendoza, Fernando was in the school for a long time, fabulous player. How you doing, Fernando? What about jazz tuning? You never tune very high. Well, I guess, it's all relative. What's high, what's low. When I'm tuning, if I have an 18-inch bass drum, 12, 14, I'm definitely going to tune higher, a lot higher. And, that's why I don't use the 10, I'll use the 12. And it's cranked so that the drum, has, more of a characteristic. I can kind of demo it real quick here that, when you start tuning up, a drum, especially bigger ones, they last not as long, they project more, but you have to be careful. For me anyway, they're too high can be really not pleasant. So, so this is the 10 inch, but this is, let's see. So it's kind of that same, that same relationship, but it's tuned a lot higher now. Yeah, so it projects a lot more, it doesn't last as long. So when I'm tuning for jazz, yeah, all the tape comes off for the most part, unless I got harmonics ringing. And it's a different thing, so that when I touch it softer, see, if I touch this drum soft, it has a pitch. So does this one, kinda, but not really. It's more tuned with that, bottom head higher, so that it has more of a thud. It has more of that characteristic the microphone likes to hear. It's gone sooner. Okay, so yeah, jazz tuning is definitely a different thing, but I get into that in the school as well.
Very cool. Any other questions you want to answer before we cut off? It seems to have gone very quickly today.
Yeah, it went quick today. The question about the studio. I'll tell you what, Michael, he asked, how big is the studio to get all the information about sound and maybe what kind of acoustic treatment you use. I'll tell you what, I'm in the, my studio build, because this is not mine, this is Autumn Hill Records studio that they're being kind enough to set me up in while mine is being built here in St. Louis area. And, it's going to be about a 2,000 square foot studio, and the drum area will be fairly large. And when the time comes, which will probably be about 4 or 5 months from now, I will take you all through what we did, because at this point, we're not exactly sure what we're going to do with the treatment. So, it's for sure, though, right now we're concerned with the sound transmission out of the room. So we're double walling everything and just clipping the ceiling. So, yeah, that'll be for a later date. But for sure, I love the wood, because it really helps the brightness of the drums. But you definitely do have to combat it and mix it up with some absorption, and they've got it in here too in the studio, combining absorbing materials with wood. So it's a very nice. Like I said, I think the room sounds very good with a combination of room mics and close miking. So that's what I'll be after as well.
So. All right, you got a few months left on that build.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, we're about to commence. It's just getting all the electricity and the HVAC prepped is a huge undertaking. So we're almost there. We're almost ready to start. That's good. Okay. Let's see. Yeah, sorry guys. It's trying to answer. There's so many questions that it's really kind of hard to.
Well, I do see here. Jonathan says a drum studio design focus would be sick. I think he means you should definitely try to document what you're doing the best that you can, and maybe we should film some of that and put that in the school, kind of from the beginning. Have you started any of the actual construction yet?
Not actual construction, no. We're okay. Still in we're in the prep mode, so yeah, the ceiling is scheduled to be started in a week or two. So we're getting close.
I think we have to make a documentary about this. So
if you can
film some of it and all that, we'll put it together. We'll put it out so that people can see how you went through this process. I think it's gonna be a pretty intense process.
Yeah, believe me, it's intense already. it's very intense, but the same folks that built Rob Silverman's rooms there in Autumn Hill Records, they're going to be building mine, so we're looking forward to it. Jay Oliver did most of the design. We kind of all designed it together, but his ideas are really, really cool, and you know, and yes, lots of tubes of green glue, absolutely. Yeah, green glue is going to be in between the two layers of drywall on the ceiling and the wall, so it's green glue, not cheap.
Now, do you have a name for the studio yet? The old one was the Garage in Los Angeles. What's this one going to be?
Not sure yet. We don't. It's not to that stage yet. We gotta see how it all feels, you know, because my place is kind of in the woods and nature, and it's a lot of deer hanging around. So I don't know. We'll take suggestions.
Well, hopefully, after you go through everything you go through to build it, you won't have to name the studio Pain and Suffering.
You know, it'll be I'm broke now. That's what it'll be. Hey, so you know, we've been on here quite a while. I'll play a little bit for you guys. It's just to demonstrate again kind of how the tuning of the drums stand up in a song, and this is I'll play a little bit of that Jay Oliver song that I was messing with before, and I edit it down a little bit so it won't be quite as long, but it's a fun song to play to, little groove thing to take you out on our Sunday today. And Steve, thanks again for being here. I want to thank everybody for coming in, tuning in. Always a pleasure to have you here and talk drums and share some stuff with y'all. Sorry, I didn't get to answer too many, you know, a lot of questions, but we thank you guys for being here.
Yeah, and I hope anyone who's really interested in this, just go to daveweckl.teachable.com and check it out. $30 a month to be in the school, 50 hours of stuff, including joining Dave's private Facebook group, where, as far as I can tell, he's answering people's questions every day, almost every day.
So yeah, I'm trying. Now that I've put down the drill for making shelves, and my wife and I were going nuts trying to help out the construction, you know, kitchen and crazy stuff, doing a new house. So
yeah, well, definitely everybody check it out. It's amazing. It's rare, and Dave puts a lot of personal attention into it, which I think is very, very cool.
Yeah, I love the Facebook page. It's all the guys. There's some great players posting videos, and it's a really cool community that everybody's conversing and hanging out in there. So it's a nice positive energy going on there. Cool.
Yeah, all right. Yeah. Good to see everybody in there, and we'll play a little bit.
Yeah, we'll play a little bit. What the heck? It's a Sunday afternoon. Let's play. Let's see. What did Jay call this? This is Spurfunctory. That's the name of the song. And again, I was kind of messing with this with Jay on our production, on our little production thing that we did together on a hang that's still up there somewhere. You can check it out. But I'll play to this today, and we'll see you again soon. And be well, be safe, make music, and thanks again for tuning in. All right. Ciao. All right, everybody. Take care. Ciao. See you. Thanks again for tuning in. See you next time.